Brought to you by
Eaton Detroit Spring, proudly made in the USA.
Also brought to you by BF Goodrich Tires, who asks, are you driver enough?
This week on Auto Resto Mod, Jeff takes over and gives some tips and tricks for setting points on a classic car distributor.
National Parts Depot is proud to offer this exclusive reproduction of the 1970 to 78 Camaro dash pad. Get one for your car and improve your ride. Check out National Parts Depot for Mustang and Cougar, Camaro and Firebird, Chevelle and GTO, Ford truck and Bronco, Chevy truck, Mopar, and Thunderbird. At our four locations, we stock the largest selection of classic car parts anywhere. Visit us at nationalpartsdepot.com or call us at 888-893-FAST.
The mighty six-cylinder.
Dude, it's begging for a turbo.
Shut up. You and the other guy that was on the video thing the other day said something about turbos. I'm not doing it. Not a six-cylinder. No.
I mean, it's not a diesel, but...
Never will be either. No, we've got the guys at Summit are going to help us out with a V8 for this thing. We got a small block 302 they're going to do with us through ATK. Cool. Got a modern driveline 5-speed for it. So we've got all these things being lined up. Classic Instruments is possibly on board for doing instrumentation in it. We'll probably talk some about doing a custom wiring harness because this wiring harness is trashed. But this week, because of you and one of our viewers getting very, very excited about points, we're going to actually show how to set up a set of points. And I have actually brought in a tool that I have that is actually older than the combined ages of two of our camera guys. So my dwell meter is actually going to finally come into some play as something other than a tachometer to check how much RPM we're turning. And this thing is actually older than you, even. That's 19.
That's really old. That's ancient.
It's like 6 years older than you.
I'm going to go and cry now.
Yeah, because it's old. And it's kind of crusty like me. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go over to the table and we're going to talk about a couple of the tools you're going to need. Not necessarily needing this, but It would be a good idea if you had one. And hit that real hard. And then we're going to go in and show you actually how to set them up in the car and some things, some tips on dual point setup as well.
Cool.
Okay? So give me that. Give me those. You go do.
Bye.
Okay, so what we're going to be talking about today is how to set up points on a classic car. Now, we're going to be working on a Ford, but a lot of what we're talking about with dwell and all that is going to be the same on pretty much anything. I will say that there are some points that we'll make a little later on about setting up your dwell. What I'm going to go over right now is what you're going to need in order to do this. Now, I will say this, that if you're doing points, you should probably also go ahead and do your condenser. But one of the first things I've got here on the table is I've got the distributor cap and rotor. Might as well go ahead and replace those when you're doing the points because you're probably going to have a pretty good bit of wear on this if the points are worn out enough to need replacement. Next thing I got here on the table is the actual set of points and the condenser that you're going to need. And I recommend replacing these together. Now, the thing I like about the guys at National Parts Depot where we got all the stuff up here is that National Parts Depot stocks the Motorcraft condenser, and this is actually a little bit better than some of the other ones I've run into. Here of late, condensers can be an issue. They can go south a little quicker than they used to back in the day. Let's face it, not too many people are doing points on cars now. So, if you're doing it, replace these as a unit. Try to get the best quality condenser that you can get for your car. The next thing we've got here is the ground lead for the car. We got a brand new one because the ground lead on ours is kind of tatty looking. I don't really know why I got it because I probably really don't need it. If I'm going to sell the engine, it doesn't matter. But when you get it, you'll get a brand new ground points lead. And then also finally here, we have a set of correct appearing plug wires for the six cylinder. We're going to put these on because they're all marked for position like the cap is. And this will go a long way to making it look a little bit nicer. We're probably going to paint the engine up, make it look a little bit better since it is going to be a good running six-cylinder when we get done with it. Now, the next thing I'm talking about on the table here are the basic tools for setting up your points. There are other things that you can bring into this, like a distributor wrench for Ford, some of the distributor wrenches for Chevrolets. All that kind of stuff can come into play with all of what you're doing. But this piece right here is an actual original dwell meter. We talked a little bit about it over there on the 65 Ranchero, but this is a real dwell meter. This is from back in the day when I was a kid when basically really pretty much all you had on classic cars was a set of points, unless you went in and did a later model distributor. Now, you can also do this with some of the ohm meters that are available out there on the market as well. So you can get dwell from an ohm meter if you do not have tach dwell voltmeter. Now, the other thing I want to talk about is your feeler gauges. You have flat ones and angled ones, and quite frankly, if I'm going to do this, I want to go with the angled because it's just a little easier to get down inside that distributor to set your points when the ends are angled rather than flat. Either one will work. In some distributors, it's kind of easy to use this one, but just keep in mind that you have an option on both of those, and they're usually available, oddly enough, still at the auto parts store, so you can go down and get you a set of those fairly easily at pretty much any place around the United States. So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to pull all this stuff out, and I'm going to go into setting up the points actually on the car. Okay, so now we've got our six-cylinder here. What we're talking about is going to apply to Chevrolet, Mopar, Ford. It really doesn't matter, but what we've got going on right now is a little tips and tricks I'm going to give you on setting all this stuff up. We've got our distributor and everything still in the car, everything in good shape. Now, last week we did this, but I wanted to kind of go over it again in case you didn't watch last week's episode. What we've done is we've gone in and actually labeled all of our plug wires so we know exactly what cylinder they go to. It's always a good idea. The six cylinders on the Ford side of things always had the numbers on the cap, or at least every one I've ever seen. You can probably buy them that don't. In any case, it's always a good tip to just go ahead and start labeling your stuff before you take it out of the car. Now, if you have an original set of plug wires like we have over on the table, those plug wires are also numbered as well, so you'll want to put those in the order they're set up in. All right, so what I'm going to do now is I'm going to go in and take the distributor cap off, because this is what you're going to have to do in order to access your points to change them out. Now this one, I'm going to, since I've got everything labeled, I'm just going to go ahead and pull all my plug wires out, because I'm going to be changing these out as well, and I'm going to be changing that out too. I'm not going to throw that because you never know, you might need it down the line somewhere. Now, take your rotor off. Whatever you do, don't forget to put this back on. I know that sounds kind of stupid and a little inane, but back in the day when I was a young fella, we missed putting this back on when we did a tune-up on a car. And believe it or not, without this little puppy right here, she won't start at all. Okay, now that I've got the cap off, what I wanted to talk to you about a little bit is some of the stuff that you can run into with a point style system. Now, points work effectively, and the manufacturers used them all the way up till about the middle 70s when they started moving over to electronic ignition. But there are some fundamental problems with a point style system, and usually I found, especially in older cars now, point systems are a little bit rougher on idle than the electronic ignition. That's because of one fundamental issue that you can run into. If you have a point system, you'll notice that on the six cylinder we have here, this looks like a little bolt inside the center point of your distributor. That is actually what controls the points opening and causing your engine to fire the way it should. It will either be a 6 or an 8 or a 12, whatever you happen to have for cylinders on this, that's how many points will be on here. And what can happen a lot of times is this one's actually not too bad, but you can hear a little bit of movement out of that, and that will change your dwell on your points and cause the car to run a little bit rough. And the other problem is this rubbing block that's on here that you can see on the back side of the, if you will, bolt head or the cam here, that will wear down and it will also change your dwell on your points. Points are kind of finicky. They require a lot more maintenance than you would have to do if you're doing an electronic conversion. If you want to keep points on your car, this is fine. That's what this is all about. I've had a lot better success with good, solid, flat idle out of a Petronix system, say, than I have out of points. Points run okay. The Petronix and electronic ignitions, I hate to say it, they just run a little bit better. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to go ahead and start pulling all this stuff out of here and show you how to set up a brand new set of points on this and go over some of the issues that we found on this point set when we took them apart last week. These screws in here are in pretty bad shape, so we're going to replace these with some that we got from the guys at National Parts Depot. The nice thing is AMK Fasteners makes pretty much anything for these classic cars to replace any of your fasteners that are bad. You see what's going on here? That's your advance. And that's basically the brains of this distributor. So when you move that, that's what you're doing is you're moving the advance. And you can check your vacuum advance and see if it works. But that's for another video. There we go. Okay, now these points actually look pretty good. They're not too badly pitted. One of the problems you can have is sometimes I've seen these where the points are actually bent. People messing around with them, doing all kind of crazy stuff. In fact, this set of points looked like this whenever we first started working on it. So you can have a problem with that. And if they're bent, you need to make sure that your points are firing on the center of your stand here. So you would want to make sure that the tab is bent. There's actually tools out there from back in the day that would allow you to bend this and put it where the points heads are firing straight across so that there's no overlap like that. You want these firing fairly straight. Okay, so I'm going to pull these out, throw those away because I don't need them, and get the new points and go ahead and put those in here and show you how to adjust them and set them up. Okay, now I've got a couple things I want to talk about on the points here. Basically, we've got our screw set. Now we got this one from, as we said before, National Parts Depot, and you'll notice that it has serrated washers on two of the screws. These two screws are for your points. This one screw that does not have the serrated washer on it is actually for your condenser. And then we, of course, from National Parts Depot, have our condenser and our actual points. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to go down in here and show you a couple little tips and tricks on in setting this stuff up and getting them to where everything's a little easier to work with. Okay, now I've set my points in my condenser together here. You're going to want to angle these a little bit because this one is going to need to go on there as well. And it has to kind of angle across from the other one. I don't want to open that up too much, just enough to get that on there. You don't want these contacting the plate either. I'm going to set this. Those are nice and tight. Now, one of the points I'm going to make about points. When you're setting these up, you don't want your cam here to be on one of the opening settings on this at all. You want this to be on the flat when you're putting this in here. So I set this in, and there's actually a little stud that goes in the hole. Another thing I'll show you too is this is a ground wire that goes into the case, and you'll need to make sure that that is under the screw hole correctly. And that can be really exciting to get that to mount up. You want to stud it first. You want to make sure you get that on there, and then set the back screw. And this is really the fun part because a lot of times you'll do what I just did there and drop it down underneath. I'm going to have to pull that back out and get that out of there. Amy. Okay, I'm going to get this back screw set. Like I said, make sure you're on the post first before you set that screw. These can be kind of a bear to get the seat and stay in place. I don't want to tighten it all the way down yet because I need to get my ground strap seated as well. What I'm going to do is I'm going to take another small screwdriver, move my ground strap into position where it needs to be, and then I'll take the other screw and start it. This is probably the more delicate of the two screws because of the position. I wish I had magnetized screwdrivers. It'd probably make that a little bit easier. Again, not going to completely tighten anything down yet. And then you just take your condenser and you place it in position as well and get that done. Now, the six-cylinder and the 289 Hypo use this barrel style of condenser that actually has a clamp on it that is up close. And the later V8s use this style of condenser, which is basically, you'll notice the mount point is further back. This will not, for some reason, mount, well, because it wasn't designed to. This condenser will not mount inside the six-cylinder distributor. This is something you can run into when you're doing a Ford. You have to pay real good attention. The nice thing is like National Parts Depot, they have photographs of the parts, so it's not like you can't look at it and not know what you're ordering. So make sure that when you're doing this that you get the right condenser for the car. This condenser would functionally work exactly the same as the old one that we have here, But we're going to go ahead after we get off camera here and order a new one from National Parts Depot that is the correct style to go in here. But for right now, I'm just going to mount it up so you can get a look at it. That's right. When we screw up, we show you. There is actually on the points an adjustment slot. You'll see there's a place for the screwdriver to sit, and you'll need a fairly wide blade screwdriver, kind of like the one I've got right here, that you can put in there. And this actually sits in that slot, and then you can open and close the points with the screwdriver to get the correct point setting that you need. So I'm going to get me another screwdriver so that I can actually close this down with this set. You'll need two screwdrivers to do this. I need another big flat blade for that. All right, now, the next thing you want to do is you want to take your cam lobe here and get this contact button right here up on top of one of these cam lobes. Now, this is where you can run into some problems on one of these types of distributors. As time goes on, these things get older and get more worn out. These cams can get worn down, and you're not going to get as sharp a contact break as you would if it was all fresh. Not as likely, because basically this button here is sacrificial. But what you want to do, in my opinion, is to get yourself a remote starter like the one we're borrowing from Cam, the high quality and very expensive Snap-on model. And you're going to want to use your remote starter to try to get that up on that cam. And hours of fun can be had doing this. It's about as good as I'm going to get it. Okay, we are up on that lobe now. Now what I want to do is go in and set my points. And I'm going to put my screwdriver in here. Now you notice I'm moving the back of the points around to try to get this set up so that these close down where they're at. I'm going to take my feeler gauge and see where I am. If you can hear it ticking a little bit, I've got way too much gap in there. So I need to muck about with this a little. I've got my gap closed off now. I'm going to retighten my points at the back a little bit. Now I'm going to open these up. Now, gap on a six-cylinder Ford 200 is usually about 24 to 26 thousandths. So we're going to go for 25 thousandths. And you may find yourself doing the too much, not enough for a while here. Okay, we are at 25 thousandths. And that's one of the reasons why they give you that variable measurement, is so that you can have that room to move, so to speak. And now you're going to tighten this down. And I bet you think you're done, right? Because you've tightened it down. But you're not. Because tightening it down can sometimes open up that gap. You have to watch that arm. You can see it doing a little bit of movement there. That means your gap's not right. There you go. That's a 25 thousandths, probably a little closer to 24, but it gives you an idea of how to set the points in there and get them set up. Now, I will continue to tighten this screw down, and what I'm doing is I'm actually holding, as well as I can, holding position while I tighten this one down. And every time I tension that, I have to check my gap. So you go back and forth on that until you get the gap just right with it completely tightened down, and your points are set. Now what you would want to do on a good running engine is check your dwell, and I'm going to show you that on the 64 Falcon hardtop we have, because that car actually, oddly enough, still has points in it. Who knew?
All right, now what we're doing here is we're measuring dwell. Now, you can see here we're running about 19 degrees of dwell angle. Now, the 260 V8 with a standard transmission is supposed to be 26 to 31 degrees of dwell angle. What dwell angle is the measurement of how long the points are closed, which allows the coil to build up a higher charge and give you a hotter spark. Since we're only at 19 degrees of dwell angle, that means that the points are too open, meaning they're not closing for long enough and that they need adjustment.
Wait a minute. So what you're saying is I got to adjust another set of points?
Yep, on the most reliable vehicle that we have. Meaning that once you do that, it ain't going to run anymore.
Thanks for the vote of confidence.
You're welcome.
All right, well, I'll shut it down and get busy.
Yay. This thing is cool.
So retro.
All right, for our final little diddly-doo here, we're going to talk about dual-point distributors. Now, the dual-point distributor was used primarily for high RPM or high-performance applications. You'll find it a lot in the Ford stuff, the 29 Hypo, Boss 302, Boss 351, even the 351 4V with 4-speed got dual-point distributors. And the points are basically both set up with the same gap, so that what you're trying to do by this is get a longer dwell for your spark to get a hotter spark out of it. Now, the problem you can run into is when setting these things up is being able to figure out what the dwell is. And the best way to find dwell on each one of those points is to take and put a card between one set of points and then fold it over out of the way. Of course, I'm not going to completely fold that over out of the way because it is a really nice shameless plug for the show. And shut the cap down on top of it, and that will keep that there so you can check the dwell on it using a dwell meter or, as we said before, an ohm meter. And you'll do that for both sets of points. You'll move it from here to this other set of points to check dwell on the other points. Because you can't just open the gap up on the other one, because then you won't know what its dwell is when you have it closed down. So this is a good way to do that. All right, well, I guess that's about it.
Nice plug.
Yeah, right. I mean, you know, if you're going to do it, you might as well do a nice shameless plug.
Bye. Hey, got a question for you.
Sure.
What does a condenser do?
It condenses things.
Good explanation.
Look, here's the thing. I wanted to give guys practical this week. If guys are interested in knowing what a condenser does, how it affects the points, how it operates the coil, how it gets from the ignition switch, what all that does in a point-style ignition system, and even, quite frankly, in something like a Petronix,
yeah,
more than happy to go into that.
Mm-hmm.
But in reality, do you really need to know what this is doing to make it operate?
Just replace it.
You just replace it.
Yeah, it's cheap.
Yeah, it's cheap. It's not that much money to do it. So, I mean, in my opinion, I'm not really interested in knowing what it does as long as it does what it does.
It works.
And if you are interested in knowing what it does, we are more than happy to tell you. So, do us a favor and come back and watch us next week on
Auto Restomod.
Have a great week, folks. I gotta go return this to Bob Oswalt.
Oh, that's expensive.
It is actually kind of expensive.
Anyway.